Ductal carcinoma in situ. Now, by definition, ductal carcinoma in situ, that is DCIS, is a proliferation of cohesive neoplastic cells confined to the mammary ductal lobular system, showing a wide range of architectural patterns and nuclear grids. When the diagnostic features of DCIS are present, they must be seen in at least two glandular spaces, otherwise they are classified as atypical ductal hyperplasia, that is ADH. There is another criteria that when diagnostic features of DCIS exist, the area involved should be at least 2 mm in extent, regardless of the number of ducts involved. Before the diagnosis of DCIS is applied, if less than 2 mm in extent, the term ADH should be used. Now, the subtypes are: DCIS can be of low nuclear grade, DCIS can be of intermediate nuclear grade, and DCIS can be of high nuclear grade. Location: it may arise in the breast or accessory breast parenchyma in the axillary tail. The mean age is around 50 years. It is usually not associated with palpable breast mass. It is often unilateral, but 22% of women develop either DCIS or invasive carcinoma in the contralateral breast. The mammogram may show suspicious calcifications. High degree DCIS present with linear pleomorphic or branching calcification, but low grade DCIS has granular or amorphous pattern. It may be an incidental finding in breast biopsy performed for other reasons. The risk factors are same as for invasive carcinoma, which were discussed in the last video. There are distinctive chromosomal changes present in the low nuclear grade DCIS, which are characterized by frequent 16q loss and 1q gain, whereas high nuclear grade DCIS show gains of p5, q8, 17q and 20q. Amplification of 11q13, 17q12, 17q24 and loss of p8, 11q, 13q and 14q. Now, why I am mentioning these changes? Because a lot of stress has been given to the molecular classification of the carcinomas. DCIS has extreme variation in histological patterns with respect to nuclear grade and architecture. Many different growth patterns can be seen. One or more growth pattern is present within the same lesion. So one should be familiar with these architectural patterns, as it is necessary to recognize DCIS. Commonest architectural patterns are solid, papillary, micropapillary and cribriform, that is sieve-like. Solid pattern: the ducts are completely filled and distended with proliferating epithelial cells. The cells are round to polygonal in shape, with distinct cell membranes and with no or minimal nuclear overlapping. The cells may form pseudorosette or microacini with polarization of the surrounding cells. There is uniform population of monotonous cells, which may show mild to moderate atypia. The central necrosis may be present, but high grade nuclear features, which are present in comedo variant, are not seen. There is a photograph showing ductal carcinoma in situ, that is DCIS, showing solid growth pattern. You can appreciate that there are two ducts which are filled and distended with uniform monotonous population of cells, showing mild to moderate atypia. Cribriform pattern: there is epithelial cell proliferation with the formation of secondary lumens. These secondary lumens are round with clean, punched out appearance. The areas of necrosis may be present, The cells have round nuclei with distinct cell membrane and with no or minimal nuclear overlapping. There is uniform population of monotonous cells which may show mild to moderate atypia. Low mitotic activity may be seen. Now this photograph shows you a cribriform pattern, that is sieve-like pattern. This photograph shows microscopic features of DCIS with cribriform pattern. Another photograph showing microscopic features of cribriform pattern in which there is epithelial cell proliferation with the formation of secondary lumens which are round with a clean punched out appearance. As I have mentioned in the beginning that one or more pattern they can exist in the same lesion. Now this photograph shows DCIS showing various growth patterns, that is solid growth pattern which is marked with solid pattern and cribriform pattern which is labeled as cribriform pattern. You can see ducts which are lined by or filled and distended by monotonous population and there are no lumini in it and forming the solid pattern, whereas the cribriform pattern show punched out lumens and they are labeled. Micropapillary pattern, the uniform epithelial cells forming small papillary tufts extending into the lumen of the duct. The papillary projections are regularly spaced around the tuft. These tufts are characterized by lacking fibrous cores, club-shaped ends, and followed by proliferation of a monomorphic cell population. The cells lining these papillary projections show minimal cytological atypia. The combination of micropapillary and cribriform patterns occasionally seen. There is extensive involvement of the breast. Now this photograph shows papillary growth pattern in which there is projection of these papillae towards the lumen. This photograph shows microscopic features of DCIS with micropapillary growth pattern and papillae they are marked with blue arrows. Another photograph which shows microscopic appearances of DCIS highlighting micropapillary growth pattern. You can appreciate numerous micropapillae present in the duct. Another photograph in which DCIS is showing two patterns in two different ducts. In one duct, there is a micropapillary pattern which is labeled with letter P, and in another duct, there is a cribriform pattern which is labeled with letter C. Now, few words about papillary DCIS. It consists of papillary proliferation which shows branching fibrovascular cores covered by a monotonous epithelial cell proliferation with mild to moderate nuclear atypia. Now, when compared to the benign papillomas, papillary DCIS has no invested myoepithelial layer, and this can be demonstrated by absence of staining with myoepithelial markers such as P63 and calponin. Now this is the photograph showing microscopic features of DCIS with papillary growth pattern showing branching fibrovascular cores covered by a monotonous epithelial proliferation with nuclear atypia. This is another photograph showing DCIS with papillary growth pattern highlighting branching fibrovascular cores which are covered by monotonous epithelial proliferation with nuclear atypia. The high power view of papillary DCIS showing nuclear atypia and lack of myoepithelial layer, you can appreciate that there is perpendicular arrangement of the nuclei to the fibrovascular cores. Now the comedo pattern, the ducts are showing extensive epithelial proliferation with marked pleomorphism and central necrosis. They must have high grade, that is grade 3 nuclei with central necrosis. There is periductal fibrosis and inflammation. They may extend into the adjacent lobules. There is retrograde cancerization of lobules often seen. Now, this is the photograph which shows microscopic features of DCIS with comedo pattern. Note that the duct is lined by pleomorphic cells with prominent nucleoli, and there is central area of necrosis which is marked with letter N. Another photograph showing DCIS with comedo pattern. The duct cells are highly pleomorphic and having prominent nucleoli which are marked with black arrow, and there is necrosis in the center which is marked with letter N. Extent of comedo necrosis. Comedo necrosis can be seen in any grade of DCIS, but is more commonly seen in high-grade lesions and is characterized by calcified necrosis within the center of a duct which is involved by DCIS. This is mentioned as an estimate of the percentage of surface area of the ducts involved by DCIS which contain comedo necrosis. Some studies have shown that abundant comedo necrosis is associated with increased local recurrence following lumpectomy for DCIS. Now, there is a table which is showing grading of intraductal carcinoma. Low grade, that is cribriform, solid or micropapillary types, minimal nuclear pleomorphism, no necrosis. Intermediate cribriform, solid or micropapillary types with minimal nuclear pleomorphism and necrosis, or moderate nuclear pleomorphism without necrosis. High grade, marked cytological ATP and necrosis, high mitotic rate. DCIS with comedo pattern are high grade. Immunohistochemistry, HER2-neu commonly positive in high grade tumors, Ki-67. More than 20% of tumor cells are positive in high-grade tumors. ER and PR, they are frequently positive in low-grade tumors. Please note that when we are going to discuss in next videos, we are going to discuss the molecular classification of breast cancers, and these parameters are repeated again and again. Classification of malignant breast tumors. Now, this classification has been modified with the passage of time and upgraded. Epithelial tumors, the most important is invasive ductal carcinoma, not otherwise specified, invasive lobular carcinoma, tubular carcinoma, invasive cribriform carcinoma, medullary carcinoma, mucinous carcinoma, other tumors with abundant mucin, mucinous cyst adenocarcinoma, and columnar cell mucinous carcinoma, signet ring cell carcinoma, then neuroendocrine tumors, solid neuroendocrine carcinoma, atypical carcinoid tumor, small cell and Oat cell carcinoma, large cell neuroendocrine carcinoma, invasive papillary carcinoma, invasive micropapillary carcinoma, apocrine carcinoma, metaplastic carcinoma, lipid-rich carcinoma, secretory carcinoma, oncocytic carcinoma, adenoid cystic carcinoma, ethnic cell carcinoma, glycogen-rich clear cell carcinoma, sebaceous carcinoma, inflammatory carcinoma, lobular neoplasm, and then the neoplasms of the nipple in which Paget's disease of the breast. But we'll be discussing important types of breast cancers, and the most important is invasive ductal carcinoma, NOS, that is not otherwise specified. Now we are going to discuss invasive ductal carcinoma, not otherwise specified, that is NOS. Now before going into the detail of that, there is a photograph which shows normal duct. Towards the lumen, there is normal duct epithelium, and outside there is myoepithelium. Now, next to it, there is ductal hyperplasia, in which there is proliferation of the normal ductal epithelial cells or luminal cells. Next to it is atypical ductal hyperplasia, where the cells are rather atypical, and they are partially filling the duct. There is ductal carcinoma in situ or DCIS. which shows proliferation of the ductal lining cells, and these cells show pleomorphism. But the basement membrane remains intact. Next to it, there is invasive ductal carcinoma, in which the cancer cells or neoplastic cells, they are infiltrating the myoepithelial cell layer and the basement membrane. Now, there is another photograph showing sketch diagram of normal duct. The cells are normal in morphology, which are shown down. And then there is hyperplasia, in which the ductal lining cells are increased in number. And again, there is another photograph which shows atypical hyperplasia, and low down, the morphology of the cells are shown. Here, the lining cells are rather atypical, and they have got a slight increase in the nuclear cytoplasmic ratio. Next to it is another photograph which shows ductal carcinoma in situ, or DCIS, and the lower arrow points towards the cells which are lining the duct, and you can appreciate that in these cells the nuclear cytoplasmic ratio is disturbed. However, they are filling the duct, but they are not infiltrating the limiting basement membrane. Next to this, there is invasive carcinoma. You can see lower down the arrow pointing. The cells, they are pleomorphic and they have got high nuclear cytoplasmic ratio. These cells are lining the duct and they are infiltrating the basement membrane. So this is the various developmental stages of breast cancer. Now, coming back to the risk factors for invasive ductal carcinoma of breast, I have discussed it in my previous video. The location of the breast mass, whether they are benign or malignant masses, their distribution is almost similar. Upper outer quadrant 54%, lower inner quadrant 14%, lower outer quadrant 10%, lower inner quadrant 7%, retroareolar 15%. The prognosis of the breast cancer depends upon early detection of the lesion. And this can be by patient self-examination or regular examination by the doctor. Mammography checkup, ultrasound, ductal lavage, FNAC or biopsy, they are the key tool in the detection of the lesion. Annual screening mammography should begin at the age of 40. Mammography is still the best screening test to detect subclinical cancers. The sensitivity of mammography is in the range of 85%. Most breast cancers occur in women with no family history of the disease, so mammography can be a useful investigation. Now, coming back to invasive ductal carcinoma of breast not otherwise specified, it is most frequently diagnosed mammary carcinoma. It has a wide age distribution, but most commonly seen at 40 to 60 years of age. The risk factors include positive family history of breast carcinoma, early menstruation, late menopause, and nulliparity. It mostly presents as palpable or mammographically detectable mass. The skin ulceration, dimpling or pod orange of skin, or nipple discharge may also be seen. The prognosis depends on numerous factors. The most important is lymph node status. Gross appearances, it present as a hard fibrotic mass with stellate infiltrative borders. Rarely the tumors appear circumscribed with pushing borders. It is gray in color with gritty yellow-white streaks. The gross appearance of necrosis may be present. There is wide variation in size depending on duration of growth before the commencement of treatment. Now, this is the photograph showing gross appearance of invasive ductal carcinoma of breast. You can appreciate the whitish area which has got an irregular line showing the presence of tumor. Another photograph showing gross appearance of the invasive ductal carcinoma. The tumor has an irregular outline. You can appreciate grayish white areas which are infiltrating into the surrounding mammary tissue. Microscopic features: the tumor is composed of cords, clusters, and trabeculae. There are some tumors which are characterized by a solid or syncytial infiltrative pattern and with little associated stroma. The glandular differentiation may be seen as tubular structures with central lumina in the tumor cell groups, rarely areas with single file infiltration or targetoid features are also present. Prominent lymphoplasmacytic response is present in 15-20% of cases. In high-grade lesions, angiolymphatic or perineural invasion is often seen. In many cases, intraductal carcinoma involving the adjacent ducts or lobular carcinoma in situ may be seen involving the adjacent lobules. The carcinoma cells also have a variable appearance. The cytoplasm is often abundant and eosinophilic. Nuclei may be regular, uniform, or highly pleomorphic with prominent, often multiple nucleoli. Mitotic activity may be virtually absent or very extensive. Now, this photograph shows microscopic features of invasive ductal carcinoma in which the tumor is composed of cords and trabeculae. Another photograph in which the microscopic appearance of invasive ductal carcinoma are shown. The tumor cells are present in small nests labeled with letter N and gland-like structures which are labeled with letter G. Another photograph which shows microscopic appearances of invasive ductal carcinoma of breast in which the tumor is high-grade, the cells are pleomorphic, and there is lymphocytic infiltration. Many grading systems for breast cancer are given in the literature, but the commonly used is modified SCRAF, Bloom-Richardson histological grading system, in which the tubule formation, the nuclear size, and mitotic count are based upon. Score 1 is given when greater than 75% of tubule formation. Score 2 when 10-75% of the tumor shows tubule formation. Score 3 when less than 10% of the tumor has tubules. Nuclear size, score 1, small regular nuclei similar to the normal duct nuclei. Score 2, intermediate size, that is 1.5 to 2 times the size of the normal duct nuclei. Score 3, high-grade nuclei, that is greater than twice the size of the normal duct nuclei. Mitotic count, score 1, 0 to 7 mitoses per 10 high power field. Score 2, 8 to 14 mitoses per 10 high power field. Score 3, greater than 15 mitoses per 10 high power field. Now, interpretation of the grading system. Nottingham combined histological grade, score 3 to 7, well differentiated, that is grade 1. Score 6 to 7, moderately differentiated, that is grade 2. Score 8 to 9, poorly differentiated, that is grade 3. The microscopic photograph which shows features of grade 1 tumor, you can appreciate well-defined tubules formation. Another photograph shows grade 2 tumor in which you can see that tubules formation are present but solid sheets of cells with nuclear pleomorphism are present. Another photograph which shows invasive ductal carcinoma grade 3 in which the mitotic figures, the prominent nuclei, the large size nuclei are evident. Immunohistochemistry, ER and PR mostly positive in grade 1 and grade 2 lesions. The high grade, that is grade 3 tumors, are ER and PR negative. There are 10% to 15% of cases in which ER positive and PR negative. HER2-new, more commonly positive in high-grade tumors. Ki-67, greater percentage of tumor cells positive in high-grade tumors.